Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he's reported to have said that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that there is a verse in Surah Al-Baqarah which is Sayyid, which is the chief of verses of Quran, and Shaitan leaves the house where it is recited. So like, if you feel fearful in some place, or you feel that there is some kind of a burden in a house or in a room, recite Ayatul Kursi loudly. It's a, you know, it's a way of being putting your hearts to rest. So when in fear, it's a great idea to recite, and the fazilat of reading this, you know, before bedtime, there's a hadith which says Allah appoints a guard who will stay till morning and let no shaitan come near you. So before you go to sleep also, I think reciting, it takes hardly 10, 15, 20 seconds to recite. Now look at the attributes that are given over here of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over there. That we start to look at different attributes. Allahu la ilaha illahu, there is no, Allah is there is no God but He. The ever living and eternal. Al hayyul qayyum, these are the two attributes coming over here. The first one will hay. Hay means He lives and His life is eternal. Like we are also living, but our life is not eternal. But the meaning of the word hay is not only Allah lives, but He lives forever. Now for us as human beings, it is sometimes very difficult to understand what infinity is. What does forever means? Because everything that we experience has a limit to it. And that's how we are programmed. That's how we don't have have an idea what does eternal life means. But that's for Allah. And His life is really not dependent on anything else. Like our life is dependent on our ability to get oxygen or ability to get the right food and etc. But Allah's life is not dependent. He maintains all forms of life. And His life is forever. As an example, like the life of a bubble is few milliseconds or few seconds. The bubble comes up, it bursts. But the life of sun is very, very long. It's billions of years. And I think Allah's life is forever, so that you need to see. Al-Hayyul Qayyum, Qayyum is also a word that used over here. Qayyima, which means it's an exaggerated form, someone who stands very firmly. It's someone who's standing very firmly and sustains and supports all forms of creation. So Allah is not only there, alive, but He's also sustaining all forms of creation, which means that everything is dependent on Him for its existence. But Allah is not dependent on anyone for His existence. He is there. He supports life. Life does not support Him. So, some people name themselves and they say Qayyum. I think this is not right. Nobody should be actually called Qayyum by itself, because this is a asma. This is the name that is reserved for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not an attribute that is there within any human beings. So, all the attributes that matter possesses, all the attributes that are given by Allah, who has given the power to water to quench our thirst. It is Allah who has given. If He takes away this power from water, it will not quench our thirst. I don't know if you have ever seen somebody who has a rabies. Rabies is a disease that comes in when a dog bites and the dog has rabies as a virus. Now this person cannot take water. You give him water, he cannot drink it. So the same water which actually is a source of life for us, which quenches our thirst, in certain condition it stops doing that. So the ability that is given to water to quench thirst is an ability that is given by Allah. The same medicine, sometimes it takes life of a person and to other person it will give life. Who gives this ability to medicine to cure our sickness? This ability given is by our Creator. He has the power. And he gave power to fire to burn. The ability of fire to burn is the ability that Allah has given to fire. If Allah wants to take this ability away from it, fire will also not burn. The fire will be there, but it will not burn. So therefore, all the attributes that are given to matter, all the attributes that we know of, these are the attributes that have been given to it by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, it's very often when I went through my education, and I'm sure all of you went through your science and physics and chemistry and biology, never did very rarely it's your teacher who would say, this ability has been given to matter or this, or uranium, this ability has been given by Allah. Sometimes we feel very shy to tell students that the ability of uranium is an ability given to it by Allah. I mean, we feel shy or we say, oh my, I mean, this is not a very scientific way of saying things. You really see teachers telling you the ability of matter is there, which is given by Allah. We take the names of those people who discovered these the properties. So we say Madame Curie was there who discovered that uranium is emitting these radiations. Yes, fine, she discovered. But who gave the ability for this matter to actually give out radiation? Nobody says it's Allah who has given this matter this ability. They say nature has done it. They say nature has done it. I think we've tried to take Allah away from the equation. We've tried to take Allah away from science. And this is not a very clever thing to do. We honor people who discover this. We honor people who discover the properties of matter and how they can be used for the benefit of mankind. All medicine and everything, these are all elements which have been mixed together and they have the ability to cure us. But the fact is that no one says who actually is the one who gave matter different properties. We discovered it. To the discoverers, we honor them. We give them Nobel Prize. But to Allah, we are not even grateful to Him. We never say, Alhamdulillah, that this matter has this property. We never say that. People never say that. And therefore, this relationship between man and Allah has weakened down. Science has weakened this relationship because we never recall Allah as the giver of these properties to matter. And I think this is something we are really missing out. With your own children, you must inculcate on them. When they read science, when they talk about clouds, the rain, the water, the life cycle, the growth of trees, you must bring into equation this flower has grown and become, and this fruit has become sweet and beautiful because Allah has given it this property. Allah has given this ability to do that. I think this is something that we really need to take it out, because our existence is only there because Allah has held us up. Otherwise, the match is over for all of us if Allah does not hold us. Now, our Prophet ﷺ would really recall Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the time. In fact, every time there was a lot of difficulty, our Prophet ﷺ, uncertainty in the life of our Prophet ﷺ, he would call Allah by his greatest name. So there is a saying of Ali radiallahu anhu, and this was during the time of the Battle of Badr. And Ali radiallahu anhu, he said during the Battle of Badr, when I wished, I could see the Prophet, what the Prophet was doing. And on reaching, I saw him in a state of sajda, constantly reciting, Ya Hayyul Qayyum. So our Prophet used to always call Allah by his attributes. And I think this is a good idea for us also. Sometimes we have made our prayers very mechanical. We make our prayers very mechanical. We rarely ask Allah, we really go beyond anything, you know, Subhan Rabbi al-Azim, Subhan Rabbi al-Ala. Beyond that, we don't say anything. We say it in a very mechanical way, just to complete three times or five times and then sit up. Use this time during your sajda and your ruku to recall Allah, to call Him by all His attributes. By His various attributes, recall Allah, especially in your nafil namaz. You must do that. You must make a habit that namaz becomes a place where you can start to have a relationship with Allah. You call Him more from your heart than actually doing it in a mechanical way. Now the next part of this is that Al Hayyul Qayyum la ta'khuzuhu sinatun wala nawm. And he is ever living and eternal, neither slumber nor sleeps overtakes him. So this is sinatum, that word that comes over here means drowsiness. That sometimes, you know, when you sit for too long, you know, you just have a bit of a drowsiness. You just go in for a second and then you're back into there. But this doesn't even happen to us. Norm actually means to sleep fully, like, you know, really going into full sleep. That's the full sleep and drowsiness that are there. So this is, Allah is really beyond this, that He needs, He has any drowsiness or any, beyond this sleepiness or beyond drowsiness. And He's above all this because He's absolutely perfect. Like Quran says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ, there's nothing like Him. We really cannot understand. Prophet ﷺ delivered a sermon regarding these four words. And he said, Allah does not sleep. And it does not befit His Majesty that He sleeps. The deeds of the day are resurrected before Him, before the night, and the deeds of the night before the deeds of the day. So all the deeds of people are constantly coming to Him, and He is, you know, he's seeing all the deeds, and he is not under obligation of anyone, since he is the provider, and each one of us is the servant. Now, the next part of this ayat is Lahu ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard, everything belongs to him. Man zalladhi yashfa indahu illa bi izni, that who is there who can intercede with him except with his permission. So he is not under any obligation to anyone, since he is the provider to all of us, and we are, you know, he is the servant under his authority. He is the master and owner of the entire universe. Lahu ma fis samawati wal ard, and there is no one above him. So therefore, no one is entitled to question him about anything that happens in this universe. And the emphasis on who can intercede, with him except by his permission. This is the emphasis on the greatness and pride and grace of Allah. No one can dare to intercede with him except with his permission. And there is a hadith in which our Prophet ﷺ said that on the day of resurrection, I shall be the first to intercede on the behalf of all human communities. This is where our Prophet ﷺ said that the day of judgment, when it will start, it will be a day of great anxiety. People will all be gathered together, and they will just be standing for the accountability to begin. But it will be a treacherous day, because the anxiety of people will be very, very high. And no one will dare to speak to Allah so that this day of judgment can start, till our Prophet ﷺ will rise and he will intercede on behalf of all mankind, that this accountability of people may begin. And he will be the first to be able to do that. So this is being said over here. There's another hadith which is quoted from the Book of Muslim, in which our Prophet ﷺ said, I will stand under the throne and fall in prostration, which means he will do a sajda, and Allah will allow me to remain in that position as long as he wills. And I will then be told, rise, raise your head and speak, and you will be heard, and intercede, and your intercession will be accepted. And the Prophet then will say, he will allow me a portion, who I will enter into paradise. So this is a authentic hadith, Prophet will intercede. So may we must pray, may we be the people on whose behalf our Prophet intercedes, so that we can be taken into paradise without any hisab. You know, a lot of people will go into paradise after their hisab is taken, but there will be some people who will be where there will be an intercession by our Prophet, and they will be taken into paradise without any hisab being there. And we must pray that we be the people over there. Because can you imagine going in front of the Allah and giving hisab? I mean, that will be a dreadful thing. I mean, that will be a dreadful thing, to stand in front of Allah and give hisab of all the things that he has given to us. So we must pray that we may be among those people who actually enter into the paradise without this accountability being taken from us. Now, the last part of this ayat is يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ. So that his throne extends over the heavens and the earth. After the full knowledge of Allah being said over here, it talks about his throne which extends over the heavens and the earth. The word kursi being used over here means seat, literally the kind of kursi that we look, which means a seat of authority. And this seat of authority, since a chair is being used as a seat of authority over here, but there is a hadith in which our Prophet ﷺ said that by Allah, who is the this is a hadith which is narrated by Abu Zar Ghafari, where our Prophet ﷺ was asked what this kursi is, or what this chair is, and our Prophet said, by Allah, who is the master of my life, the seven heavens and the earth as compared with the kursi is like a small ring, a small circle of a finger ring lying in a huge ground. So you can, it's just again an example to show a small finger ring in somewhere in a large ground. So how large this is? This is from Ibn Kathir. So this is something that is being taught over here, that the power of Allah is immense. His authority is immense. It's beyond our comprehension. We really cannot really comprehend about what this kursi is going to be, how large it is going to be, and how Allah will judge from it. وَلَا يُؤُدُوا حِفْظُهُمَا وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ, and he feels no fatigue in guarding them, and he is most high and most great. Said, this is not burdensome for Allah. To run this entire universe, this is not burdensome for Allah. His power is perfect, and this sums up the oneness and perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the next ayat, which is ayat number 256, La ikraha fid deen, there is no compulsion in religion. We cannot force people. We cannot forcefully put faith in the hearts of people. Not even our children, not even our parents, not even our spouses. We cannot. La ikraha fid deen, there is no compulsion in religion. قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيِّ, guidance and error have been made clear. فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدِ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى لَا انْفِصَامَ لَهَا وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Guidance and error have been made clear. So whoever rejects the taghut and believes in Allah, he has grasped on a firm handle which will not break, and Allah is all hearing and all knowing. So there is no compulsion in religion. The first part, you cannot force people to convert and become Muslims. There is no, in this deen, there is no duress in this deen. There is no compulsion. Faith cannot be achieved by external pressure. Faith cannot come in by people saying that I want Sharia to be the law of this country. It cannot come with external pressure. It has never come, it will never come. It relates to the hearts of people. You need to mold the hearts of people. If the hearts of people are molded, whether they are alone or whether they are with people, they will be righteous. They will act in a righteous manner, not because of some external influence, but because their heart wants to be righteous. I think this is something that we need to understand, because it's not possible for people to be forced to accept faith by coercion. It is not possible. We cannot convert people to Islam on the sword. Islam has never done that. Islam has never done that of converting people. It relates to the heart, hence it's not possible for people to convert. Our Prophet ﷺ in another hadith said, do not force anyone to become a Muslim, for Islam is plain and clear. Therefore, there is no need to force anyone to embrace Islam. When Allah directs a person to Islam, he opens his heart for it and enlightens his mind, and he embraces Islam with certainty. This is something that is there. This is, you know, if too many invitations are coming to you for doing sinful deeds, you must think that I'm doing something wrong. There's something wrong in my life that I get these. Sometimes I used to get these invitations for fashion shows and for mehndis and for all kind of, you know, nonsensical programs. And every time you would get this invitation, you would say, oh, Shaitan is really inviting me. What am I doing that he thinks that I am his friend, that he's sending me these invitations? I think this must be a cause of great concern to us if the path of sin is becoming easy for us. If the sinful path is becoming easy for us, this must be something wrong in our deeds. There must be something wrong in the way I'm earning my money. I think that must be a real concern. That must be a real concern for us, that what am I doing that is wrong? Because like it said, there's no force. Allah is not forcing anyone. Islam is there. If we accept it, Allah will make us follow that path. And whoever Allah blinds his heart and seals his hearing, then he will not benefit from being forced to embrace Islam. So if Allah puts the seal on anyone's heart, obviously nothing will be able to get him. In fact, once Umar radiallahu anhu, he invited an old Christian woman to accept Islam, and she replied, I'm an old woman and I'm nearing death. And on hearing this, Umar radiallahu anhu, he did not force her to come into the folds of Islam, and he recited this verse, La ikraha fid deen, there is no compulsion in religion. And I sometimes wonder whether this portion of Quran, the Daesh people, have they read it or not read it? Have they read this, the ISIS of this world, La ikraha fid deen? There is no compulsion, you know, fine, we need to preach, we need to teach in the best manner. We can't force people to convert, whether it is, the Christians or the Jews or the Shias, whoever. I think this is something that is missed over here. Now the word that comes over here, la ikraha fid din qad tabayyana rushd min al ghay, faman yakfur bit taghuti wa yu'min billahi. So this word that taghut comes over here, that guidance and error have been made clear. Whoever rejects the taghut and believes in Allah, he has grasped on a firm handle which will not break, and Allah is all knowing and seeing. Taghut is a word which, there's another word in that we often use in Urdu, tughyani, which means exceeding certain limits. exceeding certain normal limits, we say darya mein tughyani, or the river is exceeding its limits. So taghut applies to anyone who exceed limits. Anything that exceeds limit, which means he rebels against Allah and claims to be the master. This is what taghut is. Anything that is worship besides Allah, or anything that turns man away from Allah and leads him into evil. Now this could be anything. If people are missing their prayers because of even cricket, if cricket is making people miss their prayers, then cricket has actually become your taghut. Anything, I mean, you know, entertainment or anything which stops you from the path of Allah, that actually leads you to evil, actually that has become a taghut. Nothing is beyond, I mean, nothing should be in such, we should not be devoted to anything to such an extent that because of it, we begin to break the laws of Allah. It could be our wife, it could be our wealth, it could be our position, it could be anything. So rejection of taghut that is stated over here means whoever shuns the rivals of Allah, the idols and those whom the shaitan called to be worshipped besides Allah, and believe in the oneness of Allah, and worship Him alone, and testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. This is again from a hadith, quoted from a hadith. This is what rejection of taghut is. And then this ayat says, who rejects taghut and believes in Allah, he has grasped on a firm handle which will not break. This is istamsaka, the word that comes over here. Istamsaka means a handhold, a handhold which a very firm handhold, in fact istamsaka means a firm, something to hold firmly, and urwa means a handle which is held very firmly. So sometimes you hold on to a handle because the train is moving, and you hold on to a handle very strongly so that you don't fall all over the place. So that's the firm grip that is there for your own safety in moments of crisis. So someone who holds on to the Islam in a firm way, someone who will hold on to Islam in a very firm way, he will be protected against many destructions that will be there, and many deprivation will be there. Now the grip of Islam can be lost. This handle of Islam is so strong, it can never break. Our grip can loosen on it, but this handle will not break. We can actually lose this, as they say, chhoot sakta hai, toot nahi sakta. You can leave it, we can leave this grip, but it is not going to break. This is how strong this grip of Islam is. That's what these words, istamsaka bil urwatil wusqa, the word that comes over here, it's really describing, this is a strong grip. Allah has given Islam as a strong grip. Now you hold on to it firmly. Your job is to hold on to it firmly. Now if your grip is not strong and you lose your grip, that's not a problem with the handle. The handle is strong. You need to be worried about that my grip to this handle is strong or not. So Allah's help and protection will always be unfailing if we hold on firmly to Him and we put our trust on to Him. And we need to be more worried about the strength of our grip, how strongly we are holding on to Islam. Let's move on to the next ayat, which is ayat number 257. And in fact, after this, we're going to do a short break. Allahu waliyul ladzina amanu yukhrijuhum minaz zulumati ilan nur. Allah is the protector of those who have faith, and He brings them out of darkness into light. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاهُمُ الطَّاغُوتُ يُخْرِجُونَهُمْ مِنَ النُّورِ إِلَى الظُّلُمَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. And Allah is the protector of those who have faith, and He brings them out of darkness into light. And those who reject faith, their patrons are evil ones who take them from out of light into darkness. And those are the companions of fire, and they shall dwell in it forever. Now faith is such a great blessing. If you have strong faith, you have the greatest treasure of this world. No treasure in this world is equivalent to strong faith. No treasure in this world. Strong faith. So faith is the greatest blessing, and disbelief is the greatest misfortune. It's the greatest misfortune that a person have. A person may be poor, but that's not misfortune if he is strong in faith. And a person may be as rich as Karun, but if he has no faith, this is the greatest misfortune that is there. Because for someone whose wali is Allah, as Allah says, Allahu waliyul ladzina amanu. Now if Allah is my wali, because I am a believer, I have faith, what else do I need? What else do you need? Do you need anyone else to protect you, to be your wali? No, you don't. And Allah says over here, Allahu waliyul ladzina amanu. Allah is making a statement over here that Allah is the wali of people, those who have faith, and He brings them out of darkness into light. He brings them out of darkness into light. And what light is that? What light is that? Allah says, Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. So He brings people out to close to Him. The closer we are to this light, the closer we are to this light, the more in the state of nur we are in. Now, interestingly, that you see over here, there's one more ayah in Quran, very smaller. It says, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, flee towards Allah. Come close to this light, come close to this nur. Come close, Allah invites us to come close to this nur. Now the word nur that comes in Arabic over here, nur is singular. There's only one nur. But the word zulamat that comes over here is many different shades of darknesses. Darkness has infinite shades, but nur has only one. There's only one nur, there's only one light. And that is light. But darknesses, you know, are very, very, there are infinite shades of darkness. And no matter how weak our iman is, no matter how weak our iman is, as long as we have iman, it will take away darkness. You know, this is the property of nur. Darkness can never overwhelm nur. No matter how dark it is, even it is the smallest light, it will show. Even the smallest nur that we have in our heart, it will show in our personality. If our hearts are completely dark, then they are completely dark. Then inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Nothing can happen. Nothing can be fixed up. But even if our hearts have a small nur, the smallest nur, it will shine out all the greatest darkness that is there in this world. So this, no matter how weak the nur is, like I said, light cannot be taken away by darkness. But light takes away darkness even if it is the smallest. So like I said, Allah is the nur of the heavens and the earth, and He is inviting us to come close to Him while we are still living. I mean, we will come close to Him anyway, whether we like it or don't like it, but while we are still living, He wants us to elevate from this. Now, what does Allah mean by that? That He wants us to take us out of darkness into light. What does it really mean? If you look at this worldly things, the world is made out of what? What are the worldly things made out of? They're made out of clay, they're made out of earth, anything. Gold, silver, food, plants, animal, us, they're all made out of this clay, from this earth. The property of clay is that it is dark and it is heavy. No light penetrates matter. I mean, that's the property of a matter. It's opposite to light. Matter is opposite to light. And so therefore, whatever causes us to move close to this earth is actually taking us away from this nur. If the love of worldly things is increasing in our hearts, then be sure that the love of Allah is reducing in our hearts. If we love this world so much, we must be sure that our love of Allah is actually reducing, that our love is taking. And this is what Allah wants. He wants us to live this life. This is mata. Like I said earlier, mata is, you know, something that is, mata should be not in our hearts, but it should be in our hand. The wealth should be in our hands, not in our heart. We should not really love it. It is good as long as we have it in our hands so that we can spend. So therefore, this is so important to understand. First and foremost, we must understand who our true friends are. Our true friends are people who take us close to Allah. Those are our true friends. Not those people who take us more into this world. They are not our true friends. They are taking us away from the nur and they are taking us into darkness. But those people who take you closer to Allah, those are the people who are your true friends. And whoever Allah pleases, Whoever Allah pleases, He guides him to the path of peace and Islam. The more you are liking and the more you are visiting a mosque, the more you are reading Quran, the more you are doing zikr of Allah, it means that Allah is guiding you towards Himself. The more our namazes become a problem, the less the Quran that we are reading, the less that we are doing zikr of Allah, the more we are actually moving towards this this earth, the things and distance from Allah. So truth is one, but disbelief has many, many different shades. So this is something that we need to understand. It's only Allah who delivers His believing servants from the darkness. And darkness could be of many things. Darkness of doubt, darkness of disbelief, darkness of superstition, darkness of hesitation, of distrust. These are all the kinds of darkness that Allah can only take us out from. It's only Allah can take us out if we have strong belief in Him. And Shaitan is the supporter of disbelievers. And so therefore he beautifies this path of ignorance and misguidance. Sometimes when you look at some of these advertisements and which invites people to things which are really detrimental, you would see that how beautified these ads are for alcohol. And have you ever seen the ads for alcohol? I mean, it's sparkling and golden colored and people enjoying it. But actually for people who drink, it's a serious problem. I mean, if you see behind the facade, this is just an image that Shaitan has created. This is just an image. For people who actually drink, they want to come out of this habit of drink, because they know that every time they drink, the effects of that afterwards are so significant. It's so difficult for them to have so many problems and challenges that are there. But Shaitan, what he does is he beautifies these things. He actually makes all these things. In fact, we'll see one of the ayahs later on which talks about that, of how Shaitan puts the fear in our hearts and how he beautifies the sinful deeds for us. But this is just a beautification. This is just a creation of media. It's just a creation of media. So therefore, we're going to stop over here at ayat number 257 as we just about come close to the first hour. Inshallah, when we begin now, we're going to start with the next ayat, which is ayat number 258, and then move forward from there.